Celebrating Self is a musical journey all about discovering what makes each one of us so special and unique. Or, as my wonderful co-director, Dr. Dawkins, always likes to say, speaking your truth.
Thank you, my wonderful co-director, Dr. Israel. And yes, we implore this amongst our members and our students to speak your truth. And that's something that I learned a long, long time ago, and I wish that I had learned it when I was a college student, because it is very important to be able to speak what is on your mind and speak it in a safe environment. And that is what we try to do here, is to give them the platform to be able to speak their truth in a safe environment. And we ask you, family, friends, administrators, faculty, and staff, to allow them to speak their truth in this safe environment. What you're about to experience are individuals that are going to be vulnerable, that are willing to be vulnerable to you, to share their truth, and that's not easy. So we celebrate them, we celebrate self, and we thank you for sharing in their journey, because life is a journey in celebrating self. So on that note, we ask that you would please turn your cell phones to silence. And
enjoy the show.
Moonfinder. That's what I used to call her when she was 2 years old. One day I picked her up from daycare, and I'm carrying her to the car, and I noticed she's pointing up at the sky. So I follow her little finger, and she's pointing to the moon. In the middle of the upstate New York autumn sky, she's found the moon. Well, she used to do it a lot after that, so I started calling her Moonfinder. When she was about 3.5 years old, I wrote a lullaby for her. Moonfinder, Moonfinder, hair dark as night, eyes blue and gray like the sea. Moonfinder, Moonfinder, sweet little one, Moonfinder, precious to me. Moonfinder, Moonfinder, the little clock ticks, eager to send you to sleep. Moonfinder, Moonfinder, now close your eyes, tomorrow's adventures will keep. And there were a few more verses that went after that. Every time I played the recording for her that I made, she'd curl up in my lap and we'd have our little moment. Well, as she started to get older, Moonfinder kind of made its way for other names. She was about 11 or 12, and I started calling her Punky Pie and Punky and Piesy, Blue Girl, you know, from the old Genesis tune, Blue, Bluesy, Bluey. Well, as these names were changing and my daughter was changing, I started to notice that she was, there was no other word for it, she was kind of grumpy. I didn't know where this came from, so her nickname sort of sometimes became Grumpus. I was a little ray of sunshine. I don't know where this grumpy thing came from, and I didn't really know how to deal with it. I was never grumpy to my mom. I wanted to try to help her, you know, learn to rise to the occasion, and she wasn't always very good at doing that. I think that, in addition to all the typical adolescent stuff, I don't know, the thing that concerned me mainly was that a lot of that grumpiness was aimed right here. I guess maybe that's normal. Well, one day, she's actually sitting on my lap, and we're sitting there, and I'm enjoying her sitting on my lap again, and she's saying, Mommy, and like, no joke, within 10 seconds, had turned around to glare at me, Mom, and then, I don't know, a few seconds later, standing up, stomping her foot, going, Mother! Wow, in like 15 seconds, I had gone from Mommy to Mother. I don't even know what I did. It was like, I didn't know what to do with that. I felt like I'd been hit by a truck. And I was sitting there thinking, what did I do? What happened to my sweet little moon finder who used to like light up when I walked into a room? Oh, man. Well, needless to say, things went on and she's still kind of grumpy, but she's a really good mom herself and we're good. But you know, it makes me think about parenthood, and I think because we were kids once, we think that we're going to be able to help our kids just avoid all those pitfalls that we had to learn the hard way. But it just never seems to work out that way, does it? For one thing, our kids are completely different people. And even if they're not that different, they're growing up in a completely different generation with different concerns and challenges and difficulties, some of which weren't even invented when we were kids. Childhood is tough, but I think, darn it, parenthood is harder. I mean, no one would ever want to go through childhood again, right? But when you're a parent, not only do you have all your own concerns and struggles and difficulties and heartbreaks, but you have all your kids too. When your child is hurting, you hurt, and you want to help them, and you're supposed to be teaching them to help themselves. Well, sometimes we just get it so wrong. Don't you wish kids came with an instruction manual? Or maybe a map? Something that would help you help them navigate all those childhood and adolescent minefields. Can we try to have an optimistic outlook? Can we buck up just enough to see the world won't fall apart? Maybe this year we decide we're not giving up before we've tried. This year we'll make a new start. Another stellar conversation for the scrapbook. Oy. Another stumble as I'm reaching for the right thing to say. I'm kinda coming up empty, can't find my way to you. Does anybody have a map? Anybody maybe happen to know how the hell to do this? I don't know if you can tell, but this is me just pretending to know. So where's the map? I need a clue. Cause the scary truth is I'm flying blind and I'm making this up as I go. Any ideas? Another masterful attempt ends with disaster. Pour another cup of coffee and watch it all crash and burn. It's a puzzle, it's a maze. In a million ways, but each day's another wrong turn. Does anybody have a map? Anybody maybe happen to know how the hell to do this? I don't know if you can tell, but this is me just pretending to know. So where's the map? I need a clue. Cause the scary truth is I'm flying blind. I'm flying blind. I'm flying blind and I'm making this.
Revealing more of itself. Like the very best of stories, like a flower unfolds itself to us shamelessly in a naked, fractal moment. Once, around a decade ago, very, very far from here in Alaska, I was TAing at a summer fine arts camp. Something had gone wrong with the registration system, and some classes had 30 kindergartners, and some had three. And in my class of three kindergartners, I had two young boys with ADHD and one small, frail, white-haired girl, nearly albino, who was on the autism spectrum. The boys were loud and distractible and fun. I mean, they were kindergartners. What do you expect? They're running around. They didn't care about anything. But the girl, she was very patient and quiet. And so while the teacher and I spent all of our energy trying to keep these two boys occupied, she would sit on the floor for an hour in the corner with her ears covered up by her hands because the boys were so loud. Now the first day, it went okay. And the second day, it was a little harder, but we made it through. But it was on the third day that my heart was broken. We were running around loudly singing Abby Yo-Yo and making up verses on the fly when she started to sob. I can't do this. I need to leave. I can't do this. And the teacher stops, stunned, because these were the words coming out of this tiny little girl, right? Word for word. And he walks over and leans down and he tries to console her. Oh, it's okay. Everything's fine. No, it's not. And he looks at me, helpless. He has no idea what to do. Now, I've been through these experiences before, needing this quiet, needing this attention, and having it completely shunted onto these louder people, right? So I traded places. And I looked at her sobbing on the floor. And I knew that she needed to leave. She wanted to leave. But I knew no matter where I took her, it wouldn't help at all. We do these symbolic gestures where we try to make things better, even though when we try, we know it won't work. So I leaned down to her and I said, I can take you away. I can take you to the gym, but it won't help. And she raises her tiny little hand and I take it in mine and I lead her to the gym. Now in the gym, there's a group of around 50 kindergartners laughing, screaming, playing. You know, we're holding hands and I'm basically leaning down and she's just so small and it's so loud and I'm covering my ear. And she's up here and she's covering her ear. We're both walking in. She's got tears on her face and it's so loud. And at the far end of the gym, there's this fold-out table with three women sitting at it. And they see us and they scurry over. They flock to us. And the first one looks at me and says, why did you bring her here? And the other two walk over to the little girl and think, oh, poor baby. Oh, poor thing. Everything's okay. Everything's all right. Nothing's wrong. And she looks at them furious. She's furious. And she goes, no, it's not all right. You don't understand. And she crumples to the floor next to the wall. And she says, it wasn't supposed to be like this. They were so stunned, it was the weirdest thing. They just turned around and they walked away like we didn't even exist. She had come ready for a fine arts camp. She'd come ready for a music class, not screaming Abby Yo-Yo and running around. And I knew that. And I'd been there so often. And somehow I was the one who was supposed to take care of her. I was 13. So I sat down next to her and I said the only thing I could think of, what I wish someone had said to me. And I said, you're right. It's not okay. And they're lying because they want you to be quiet. And it wasn't supposed to be like this. And so she was so lost in her emotions at that point, so crumpled up, she didn't even respond. I don't know if she heard me. And in the end, I had to leave her there in the gym alone. I never saw her again. I'll never know what happened to her. And I thought the lesson then was that it takes a village to raise a child and a special village to raise a special child. And I'm so sad that it took 7 years for what is now so astoundingly clear to me to hit home. Another lesson, one that I learned the very hard way. She didn't try to change anyone. She didn't pretend it was okay. She left and she didn't come back, and that was the right thing to do. And I wish it hadn't taken me years of trying to fix a disaster to understand that. The helplessness that I felt in that moment was astounding. And I hope that I can explain it to you through this song.
In places and times that seem completely true, but at the same time, completely different. The more that we want, the more powerful our need. To be where we want to be, we need to be lost first. throughout my life, I lose myself in places and times that I wasn't there, especially in Greenville Tech College. That is until my grandmother led me, and here I am now. Dancing bears, painted wings, things I almost remember, and a song someone sings once upon a December.
Told the very first person my entire life that I was gay. And from that moment, it started a journey of a lot of confusion and pain and frustration, but it also started a journey of love and acceptance, and I wouldn't trade myself coming out for anything. I grew up in Utah, and I grew up a member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, and to a lot of you that would be known as the Mormon Church. And in regards to homosexuality, the church teaches that being gay, or as they refer to it, as struggling with same gender attraction, is not a sin as long as you don't act on those feelings. And so that left someone like me left with two options. Either I got married to a woman and just hid that part of me and did everything that the church wanted me to do, or I remained single and not get married to anybody and still did what the church wanted me to do. So either way, I was not going to be happy. And for quite a few years, I felt that that's truly what God wanted for me. And I did everything that the church required of me. I did everything to prove to God that I was worthy of his love, that I was worthy to marry a woman and make it work, even though I was gay. And so I dedicated 2 years of my life to serve a mission. I left the country and I learned a new language, completely out of my comfort zone for 2 years of my life, completely volunteered. And I was positive that if I did that, that when I came home, God would somehow take this burden away from me. And I remember coming home and it just didn't happen. I was still gay. Nothing had changed, other than I learned to speak Spanish. And that's when I started to realize that in order for me to be truly happy, I needed to do what was right for me. I needed to be who I am. And last year, I got married to a man. And my family wouldn't have any part of it. We didn't speak for a very long time. From the moment we started dating and we got engaged, we didn't talk at all. And it was really hard. I had to tell them, either you accept us as part of the family or you don't get to have me at all. And they ended up saying, all right, well, if that's how it's gonna be, then that's how it's gonna be. So and I had to make that decision. And then a few months ago, they reached out and said, we are having a family get together back in Utah, and we would like you both to come and join us. And I was shocked that they were inviting both of us to come to this family get together. And we went, and we flew back to Utah, and I was so afraid. I didn't know what would happen. And they were so good to us. And it was a great experience. And later, my mom, when we had come back here to Florida, my mom had sent me a message and she said, you know, thank you for coming. We were happy that you were there. And I'm sorry, we were wrong. And it just, the reason I share this is because it's just so important to be yourself. No matter how hard it is, it will always be better. And for the longest time, I didn't think that it would. I thought that I would really have to just learn that and be okay with my family just not being part of my life. I thought that that's what I would have to sacrifice. And in the end, it worked out. And, you know, we still have our differences. We still have our differences of belief. But there's progress, and I still stand by my decision in staying true to who I am. So today, I will sing a song from a show called Bear. It's a musical. It's not very well known, but I highly recommend you all check it out. It's wonderful. But I think as I sing the song, you'll be able to see how it relates to my experiences. Everything's an act when you're pleasing everyone, and he assumes that role to such renown. He plays a perfect part straight from his heart, knowing the risk he takes and hoping that the house is not brought down. The role of a lifetime, it's living a fantasy. A drama that you struggle to erase. Thoughts battle words over deeds, a war with such casualties. All played out behind a smiling face. God, I need your guidance. Tell me what it means to live a life where nothing's as it seems. Spending days in silent fear and spending nights in lonely prayer, hoping that one day when you wake, those feelings won't be there. So confused because I feel complete with him. When we're alone, it all somehow makes sense. Look into his eyes for some compromise. Remember the word forget and try to bury something so intense. You learn to play the straight man, your lines become routine. Never really saying what you mean. But I know the scene will change. White picket fences and a dog, a trophy bride and children. God, I know that's what he wants. But Jason, what role do I play? Am I a savior or a face? Am I here to damn you or to help you navigate this maze where confusion is a crime? So you fill your life with sound, and if you dance like hell, you hope you'll never touch the ground. What happens when the music stops? In the silence, will he stay? One day you'll realize that these feelings aren't going away. So we drive ourselves insane, spinning circles in our souls as we dance around and play pretend. Then once again, reprise our roles.
Dear Grandpa, I'm fat, but I don't like it. Sometimes I think that there's something I could do. I could diet. You and I both know I like good food too much. I could exercise. I know that you used to love to run, but I hate being sweaty and hot. Maybe I could just stop eating altogether, but I know that's an eating disorder waiting to happen. But then I think that maybe something could change. Maybe I could finally be considered beautiful. Maybe I could have some semblance of something they call confidence. But then again, I think it wouldn't even matter. Sometimes I think I should stop crying so much. Just walk down all those feelings down in the dark recedes where they came from, where they crawled from. Where I could just be normal. But then I have friends who tell me being normal is overrated. I've been this way forever, been excluded forever, been told I'm too much, not enough, not there. Why are you so stupid? Why are you so weird? Why are you so retarded? Why are you so goddamn loud? I cut my hair in eighth grade because you didn't come to my bat mitzvah. You said you liked it long, so I chopped it all off. I hated it. It was long and tangly and got knots. So I chopped it all off. But then the questions started. Why did you cut your hair? Hey, my brother would say to me, you look like a lesbian. And then little kids run up to me at summer camp and ask me, are you a boy or a girl? And I have to say, I don't know. But I guess the real question is if I changed everything about myself, every aspect, would you finally love me? If I lost 100 pounds, would you stand up and give me a hug? If I grew out my hair, would you tell me I look good? If I stopped talking so much, would you listen to what I really want to say? The problem is I know that I could visit a million alternate universes looking for that perfect person that you wanted. But now you're dead and it doesn't matter. That perfect person doesn't exist. That person that you want is not the person I see in the mirror. Look at me, I will never pass for a perfect bride. Or a perfect daughter, can it be? I'm not meant to play this part. Now I see that if I were truly to be myself, I would break my family's heart.
Identifying me, all of my struggles and pain made me who I am today. So many people doubted me and put labels on me. I remember growing up, people said so many hurtful things to break me down, and I let all those things get to me every single day. So what I do, I started to be just like them. Tried to fit into this image that they wanted me to be. Tried to fit in, but yet I was still rejected. I was never comfortable in my own skin, and nobody ever cared how I felt. But as I grew, other people saw something in me that I didn't see in myself. They saw my beauty, my intelligence, and my desire to do more. And then soon after that happened, everything everybody else said didn't matter, because I became who I wanted to be. And I was free from all those labels, all those insecurities that had me bound. And now I'm finally free. I'm finally free of all my insecurities. I can finally say, this is me.
I'm not. This is me.
Thank you all so much for coming out. Give yourself a round of applause. Our president, he's the one that's been supporting us since day one, always been there. Introducing President Dr. Haggerty.
Right, well, up in this rope, some tears in your eyes, you want to. This is a very special time, and it's Parents' Weekend, which is absolutely one of the joys of the community to have everybody here and celebrating self and celebrating the community. We have with us today the former chairman of the board from 2002 to 2014, whose shoulders we at Beacon have stood on for a very long time. His name is Dr. Richard Williams, and he's here with his wife Sally and his daughter Noy, graduate of the class of 2002. So I hope that Dick recognizes that things haven't changed much. We still have the beautiful spirit here and the beautiful sense of self and sense of community. So we all owe you an applause, Dick, and I know this is embarrassing for you. We're blessed by this performance, because it was an open sharing with a community that is different in many ways, but primarily we embrace the diversity of the world as it is expressed in whatever way. And it's a community that has, first, academic rigor, but secondly, an understanding that in diversity, we all succeed. And I go back to my childhood and the sense of community I had with family, which we have with the parents, and with friends, which we have here as well, and with teachers. And given my Boston roots, I thought we might close with a celebration of the community. So I'm going to ask the beautiful choir to please join me.
Yeah. where everybody knows your name.
We just want to make a statement. This is our last performance, and I just want to say something really quick while I have all the wonderful performers behind me. So I've personally have been involved in theater for a good chunk of my life, and I don't think I've ever been so proud to be even the slightest bit involved in a production as I am of this show. And that's both because of the amazingly touching stories and message that echoes throughout each of our performers' pieces, but also the extremely hard work that I know each one of them have put in to their own pieces as well as to the show together, and how supportive they've all been of one another, and allowing them to, as you've been saying throughout this whole show, speaking their truth and being very open with one another. So I know I speak for both Dr. Dawkins and myself in saying that we're very, very, very proud of each one of these performers behind us and of the show as well.
Yes. I'm trying to hold it in because every single time I watch this, please stand. We want to thank you, because without you, this wouldn't happen. Dr. Hyde. Thank you, Ms. Sharon. You have played so hard. And Peter, thank you so much for sound. Yeah. You made it sound so great. You are wonderful vocalists, thank you. Ms. Serena, please stand forward. Thank you for sharing your story. Besides ushers, thank you so much, Beacon Ushers, thank you so much. But would my husband come out, please? You are the love of my life, and you are my partner forever. So thank you for all of your help. For being here, and thank you for allowing them to share their truth. And I ask you to continue with having them live and speak their truth, because that's the most important thing, is it not? Yes, it is. So thank you. All right, and music.
Go eat cookies.
Yeah.
Go.